Good morning, Crosspoint. Happy Valentine's Day. We just want to thank you for coming here today, or those of you watching online. I just want to welcome you. Glad that you could be here. Glad there's no snow or ice to worry about this morning. The Lord helped, helped with that, push it south or north or wherever, whichever way it went, but it was safe for all of us to drive this morning. I'm glad for that. We thank him for that. Today, I just want to... In addition to wishing you happy Valentine's Day, just want to thank you for coming and for the Lord helping us through another week. We just want to lift him up today. We want to worship him and glorify him in everything we do. So let's begin the service with a word of prayer. If you could just stand with me, please, as we go to the Lord. Father, we want to thank you for all you do for us. We thank you for the love you've shown to us, and you continue to show it to us each and every day. We thank you for all the goodness you show to us through our families, our friends, this church. We just want to thank you for everything. We can't just imagine how much love you have for us, but we just hope that you would allow us to share some of that love with other people. We thank you for the blessings you give to us, but we also know that many people are hurting, and we just pray that you would wrap your arms around those that have lost loved ones, those that that are hurting for other reasons, maybe for financial reasons, loss of a job, or whatever it might be. We just ask that you just wrap your loving arms around them. We pray for Pastor Rochamont's family and his wife Marie and all the family, that they would just be encouraged during this time of his passing, that you would just, again, encourage them, let them know that he's with you, remind them that he's with you, and that all of those that know Jesus as their Savior that have been gone recently because of sickness, maybe through the virus that we have going on right now, or something else, some other reason for their passing, we just pray that you would just remind the families of where they are, and the encouragement that they just encourage them that they too can just know where their loved ones are and where they're going to go in the future. And we just ask that you would strengthen people, those that are emotionally down, maybe during this time of year. It's a rough time for them, and during winter, just strengthen them emotionally. Pray for those that are sick physically, that those that have COVID-19 would recover, that you, the great physician, would just heal them and restore them to health. For those that are going into maybe in for cancer treatments or for surgery for some other reason, we just ask a special touch upon their lives, that you would watch over them during the days and weeks ahead. We pray for Pastor Dwight. Just lift him up, strengthen him. Continue to heal his body while he recuperates and recovers. Just give him the strength to come back here rejuvenated and excited to be here. I know he misses us and we miss him, but we just pray that you would help him focus on restoring his body physically now, and just you would do that for him. Be with us as we worship today. We pray that your Holy Spirit would just touch people's lives. Your Holy Spirit would speak to those that maybe don't know Jesus as their Savior, or those of us who do. We need the message from you today that we need to hear. Help us to know what your word is telling us, what you, your Holy Spirit, is telling us. And we just ask that you would just encourage us today and bless us. We just want to lift up everything to you and pray that you be glorified. And just as we worship you and lift up your voice, lift up our voices to you, that we would hear your voice as well. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you.
Seated. Well, this morning we again have a special guest with us. As Pastor Dwight is away, last week she spoke to us, and will the rest of this month as well. Dr. Anita Eastlack is not only the wife of our district superintendent, Dr. Carl Eastlack, but she's also the executive director for church multiplication and discipleship in the Wesleyan Church. So she's one of our, not only not a district leader, but a leader for the entire Wesleyan Church, helping us to not only our church, but all the churches to grow, to have other churches created, which is what we have been hearing God tell us to do as well. Disciple others, spread the gospel, create new churches, continue to multiply churches. So we want to welcome Dr. Anita this morning to the pulpit, and we just pray God's special blessing upon her as she brings the word to us.
Thank you so much. It is great to worship with you again this week and through the month here of February. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you, and I pray that today's word will be encouraging to you, no matter what your marital status is, whether you have someone special that you're going to be celebrating Valentine's Day with. In the Bible, we read of a few different kinds of love. We're going to talk about love today, but we're going to talk about agape. We're going to talk about God's love. There's brotherly love. There's romantic love. We're talking today about agape love. So happy Valentine's Day to all of you. God loves us. And I just want to say hello to everyone who's watching online. Isn't it great to have technology so that we can even worship with each other, even if it's from a distance? And I'm sure that Pastor Dwight is either watching now or he will later once it gets posted online. Another miracle of technology, isn't it great? And we do pray for Pastor Dwight to be healthy and to get stronger and stronger. Last week, we talked about how through this pandemic, God has humbled us, similar to the way that he humbled the children of Israel in the Old Testament for those 40 years in the wilderness. We also thanked God that it's not going to be 40 years of this pandemic. And then how also we could see God's faithfulness. Just as the children of Israel, their clothes did not wear out. He gave them food every day. We have been blessed by God's faithfulness. And we finished last week realizing that's the good news that we have to share as we go home with family members who perhaps have not put their faith in Jesus yet, or our neighbors, our coworkers. We don't see and talk with as many people now during this COVID time, but we still have good news to share with the people that we are interacting with. So, just by raise of hand, did anyone get a chance to have an opportunity to share something to point people to Jesus at all? Just raise your hand if you happen to have. Wonderful, wonderful. Praise the Lord. Earlier in the first service, a couple hands were raised, and then after service, it was wonderful to hear a few testimonies, and I'll stand out there after this service also if anyone wants to just give a witness, give a praise to the Lord for how he gives us opportunities to share Jesus and to point people to Jesus. I'm going to read an Old Testament passage and then a New Testament passage. If you want to find it in your Bibles or on your Bible app, you can turn to the book of Psalm, chapter 118, and then you can go to 1 John in the New Testament, not the Gospel John, but 1 John, which is later close to the book of Revelation. Psalm 118, we're going to read about God's agape love, and then in 1 John chapter 4, also read about agape love. Psalm 118, beginning with verse 1. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. I'm sure God would love it if I would say, let the house of Pastor Dwight Mikesell at Cross Point say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, His love endures forever. And then the very last verse in that chapter, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. Say it with me. His love endures forever. And then in 1 John chapter 4, I'm going to read beginning in verse 7, and I want you to look for two different things. I'm reading from the NIV. I want you to look for when it says, God is love. Certainly He is loving. God gives love. I want us to see and hear that God is love. Great distinction for us today. And then also I want you to notice that there is a sentence in here that has two letter word, a powerful word, S-O, so, right in front of the word love. I want you to catch that. So loved, okay? Verse 7. Dear friends, do you hear him? Don't hear my words. Don't hear my voice. Don't hear this from me. Listen, the Lord is giving you a message. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. For no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is made complete in us. And verse 13, this is how we know that we live in Him and He in us. As we consider love, I'm going to take us to one verse that I believe is central to the whole Bible. If we were to only look at one verse to understand God's love, we could go to that verse that we often see at football games, John 3:16. It's so common. It's common because it's so powerful. It's so good for us to know this verse, John 3:16. In fact, I'd like to invite you to say it with me if you want to, if you know it. And I'm going to say it from the King James Version because that's how I grew up memorizing it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, for the rest of this time, I'm going to probably just say it in the NIV, regular words. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. In this verse, I see four events and one message of love. Four events in history that share with us from Genesis to Revelation. First, I want us to take this in ourselves because God loves us so much. I have love, but I must confess, my love wears down really quickly. My love is hardly ever enough. I often fail with my love because it's not enough. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, you know the love chapter? Remember, it says, love never fails. That's not talking about Anita's love in there, because my love often fails. That's talking about agape love, never fails. And so today, for a few minutes here, just take it in. The fullness of God's love for you, for me. Because then, when we go out to our families, to our neighbors, to the world, then we'll have something to give. Then it will be unconditional, everlasting, truly God's love. And I see four events with one message of love in this powerful verse, John 3:16. And the first event that I see is creation. Creation. Genesis 1:1, say it with me. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth for God. With a capital G. You know there's only one God with a capital G. The one true living God. The creator God. Now there are many gods, lowercase g, because a god is something or someone that people worship. There are many lowercase g's throughout history, or even in our life, that they try to tempt us to worship our money or our things or people. But there really is only one true living God, and he wants our worship. He wants our full worship. He wants to be our only Valentine today. One true living God, he's the one that created the heavens and the earth, and then he created people, Adam and Eve, in his image. We are all created in God's image. And that's where we see he put his stamp of love on us as a father passing on his image to the next generation. We are made in his image, God the Creator, lovingly. Even though we also see love in the creativity of all of nature, all of creation, you can just see a loving God giving us all of this to enjoy. For God so loved the world. And that, for God so loved the world. Do you hear that two-letter word in there that's powerful? So loved. We would have been happy to just have love. But it says, so loved. In 1 John 3:1, it says, how great the love the Father has lavished on us that we would be called children of God. And that's what we are. We have lavishing love on us. Do you sense it today? Can you receive it today? Can you believe it today? That before you go out and share it, that you would allow God. Because we must admit, we get emptied through the week of all this love. And we need to be filled up anew and afresh to take it in, to receive. So loved. How great the Father has lavished his love on us that we should be called children of God. And that's what we are. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We are loved today. Even if we might not be with our Valentines today, we are loved today. For God so loved the whole world, every single person, so much of our life, so many of our questions can be answered if we trace it back to, for God, the Creator God, who created everything and set everything in motion. He's the one that determined how things work. He's the one that determines right from wrong. We don't decide. We don't make it up as we go along. He's the one. It's called the authority of Scripture. So loved every single person, the whole world. That informs us as we go out and love. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. This is the second event, and I'm going to call it Christmas because that's the term that we use in our everyday language with our calendar. Theologically, that would be called the incarnation, God becoming human, the incarnation. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. I've been to Israel a few times, and I remember the first time looking forward so much to going to Bethlehem. Now, of course, the whole trip was wonderful, and now I have a couple other like favorite places where I could walk where Jesus walked. But that first time, I don't know why, but I just couldn't wait to see and experience that place where they are pretty sure baby Jesus was born. And we went to that place, and it's called the Church of the Nativity, where it's built over top of the cave where they believe Mary and Joseph spent that night when there was no room in the inn. And every day in Bethlehem, now here, isn't it cool that you get to live in Bethlehem? And you've got the star and everything. I must admit that it's hard for me to call it Bethlehem. I still call it Bethlehem because I'm not from here. But it's so cool that we're talking about this in Bethlehem today. But it's a very busy place every day of the year because Christians all around the world go on a pilgrimage to walk in Jesus' footsteps. And so this church is always very full. And they put you in a line, and there's always a long line. And the first time we were there, I was with my husband and my two older children, and then the group that traveled with us. And it took a long time in that line. And the closer we got to the steps, a couple steps that would go down into the cave, the more the line turned into just like a crowd. And I noticed how there were even elbows starting as we got closer to that narrow place to go down. And I thought, that's interesting that Christians would come to walk where Jesus walked, and now we've got elbows. But I was thinking, as long as my family of four could go down there together, and we would have like a moment together, a spiritual moment. But the closer we got, the more I realized this crowd is dividing us. I might not be there in my imagination, what I was hoping to have the four of us have a moment. And we got separated as we started stepping down. You know how so much can go through your head, and it probably was only a few seconds. But I noticed as I was stepping down, there was a priest down there, and he was kind of shooing people on, like, get in, get out, get done. And I'm thinking, I just want a moment. And I stepped into the dark with a candle, and I kind of just blocked everything, and I knelt down. I thought, I'll quick kneel down. And as I knelt, I just got washed over with so much emotion, and all I could think of was, Jesus, you loved me. That this much you loved me, this much that you would go from God to a brand new born baby. And I just a few times just said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm sure it was only like 3 seconds. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Right there on the stone floor, they had engraved a Star of David. And I just had a moment with God's presence all around me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. You loved me this much? And then I heard the priest, move along, move along. But that's how much he loves us. Every day, not just Christmas. And what was his motive? For Christmas, his motive is love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And the third event, we call it Good Friday and Easter, the death and resurrection of Jesus. And I put them together because one goes with the other. The death and resurrection of Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him, and it points us to Good Friday and Easter, because this is what we believe. This is the reason that Jesus came, to die on the cross, to take the penalty of our sin upon himself. He died humanly, physically. He was dead, buried, and the power of God 3 days later brought him up from the dead, conquered not only sin, but conquered death itself, that whoever would believe in Jesus, the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, that we would believe what Jesus said about himself in John 14, verse 6. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is not something that is our opinion, what we made up. It's not our truth. It is God, the Creator's truth, that whoever would believe in Jesus, that's why there's a sense of urgency that we would take this love that God has lavished on us and that we would share it with the world and that we would point people to Jesus. And the next event is heaven. Life is short, isn't it? And we will all be finished here on earth someday. In fact, Dr. Carl is over at our Huntington Wesleyan Church in Long Island because Pastor Rochamon, that Kevin was praying for earlier, passed away suddenly last week. And so Carl was there for the funeral yesterday and the sermon for today. We will all face eternity, either through our natural death, or the Bible even talks about the second coming of Jesus, where he will come, as the Bible says, from the clouds, just as he ascended. The Bible says he will come again. Listen in John 14 with Jesus talking about this event. "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in Jesus would not perish, but have everlasting life." Why? Because God wants us to live with him for eternity. He's lovingly preparing a place for us, motivated by love. Four events with the same message of agape love. We as Wesleyans, with our theology, we read scripture understanding that love is at the center of our theology. Now, not every theology reads scripture in this way. Some theology puts sin at the center, and you can follow the same scripture and come to the same conclusion. I just appreciate that we have love at the center so that we're always motivated by God's love reaching out to people, because then that love leaks out. And just like you can tell when somebody really respects you or doesn't respect you by their words and actions, your neighbors, your family members that don't know Jesus yet, the people you come in contact with, when you are filled to overflowing with that lavishing love, when what you believe is centered in agape love, it shows up in the way we believe about ourselves, in the way we communicate with people. It's agape love, for God so loved the world. And yes, he died for our sins. And without receiving that, we are lost in eternity without Jesus, without heaven, without God. We need to believe in Jesus and the work that he did on the cross. And as we finish here this morning, and we're going to go to communion, for those of you who picked it up here at the counter, I want to pray first. If there's anyone here or even watching online that you've never taken that step to put your faith in Jesus, to receive the loving forgiveness from God for your sins, because we can't do enough good works. We can't say we're sorry enough to wash over and to forgive our sins. Only Jesus' blood on the cross, death on the cross, forgives our sins. And then we receive it by believing in him. If you're ready to do that today, I'm going to pray. And I'm just going to use my words that you can listen and follow along. And then you also put it into your words that you would talk to Jesus to believe in him. Thank you, Jesus, for your love, your agape love, your unconditional, lavishing love, that you would go to the cross to forgive me. You would go to the cross so that I wouldn't need to. You would go to the cross for each and every one of us to cleanse us from sin. And God, for that person, for whoever is praying this right now, thank you that you hear their prayer to say, I'm sorry for my sin. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. I receive your love. I receive forgiveness. And thank you for giving me the promise of heaven. Thank you for making me a child of God, a Christian today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Welcome to the family if you prayed that prayer. And I just encourage you to share that with someone. Tell someone. It's good news. It's not something to be embarrassed about. It's good news. And as we go to communion now, you can take the top plastic off. And I'm going to read a scripture in 1 Corinthians 11. It says, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. do this in remembrance of me. And before you take it, tell him, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And as we open up the cup, in this